Thanks everyone for coming. Actually, this session is about the Azure or the blockchain as a service, and it is a kind of a workshop. So you might need a laptop and follow me along, okay? So that's the main objective of the workshop. I don't know whether some of them might know, but anyway, I'll go through the steps, or I would just explain what is Azure as a blockchain as a service initially, then I would go through the workshop so that you would know what is service, then you can do the workshop, okay? And meanwhile, those who are willing to do the workshop, you should register the Azure pass which he had given. And the pass which he has given might have $100 credit, USD credit, and the credit starts to run kind of the time when you start to register, and it is for 1 month valid. So even though whether you use it or not, after one month it is gone. So 100 USD for 1 month. Okay. So whatever you can run within that 100 USD a month, you can use it. But after this workshop, Azure blockchain credit will take more credit. So which means that if you set up the Azure blockchain workshop now, maybe it might expire in 2-3 days because it consumes so much of the credit. It doesn't, the $100 credit might not be sufficient because monthly it's more than 1,000 plus. The one he had, maybe you can distribute it. So note down the URL, and meanwhile you can start to register. And one more thing, as I mentioned you before you register, make sure that you log out of all the live ID and you have the live ID of the registration which is handy. For example, the scenario is I might have my personal live ID which is very, very personal, used it in mobile. You don't want to really register that for the for the free pass. So make sure you log out of that in all the browser and get a live ID which is some other live ID which is already ready. Then use this URL, click on, I'll go through the steps, then in that you should use the live ID, okay? So in case if you are keen on registration. Okay, so before I start the workshop, what I do is I quickly run through what is a blockchain as a service so that you have some idea about it. This is about my profile. So if you want to follow me, this is my profile. I do more Alpine development plus the blockchain. You can follow me on the Twitter. So let me go through the last slide, which is Azure blockchain. Oh, the my picture? Sorry. Today I didn't, maybe you can follow. Okay, everyone done, sorry. Real one, it was taken in the Seattle, the wheel. Actually, I was wearing the green t-shirt, then the guy. Yeah. I was wearing a green t-shirt, then when I took the picture and it was out, they overlaid the green with the, so it becomes like overlaid. I don't know what they did, okay. Okay, so basically blockchain as a service, which is called as the Azure Blockchain Workbench, which is one of the service provided by the Microsoft on the Azure. Microsoft has other blockchain development as well, which means that if you are core blockchain developer, you just want to make use of the Ethereum or the Hyperledger, they have a separate options as well. This is one of the options is primarily targeted for enterprise customers who already been into, who already have their existing enterprise setup with the Active Directory ready, SharePoint or SQL, so they already have the kind of full infrastructure ready and they want to move into or embrace blockchain easily, then this is one of the options which Microsoft provides you. So they call it as an Azure Blockchain Workbench, or like Azure as a service. I mean the blockchain as a service. Okay.
So that means that you can do all this application on blockchain.
Yes, easily. Yes. So you, later I show you how it is. Okay.
So is it specific platform, your own platform? Because you mentioned Ethereum, Hyperledger and all that. So is there a particular platform?
I would mention you later, next slides. So if you see here, this is the overall architecture of the Azure Workbench. And the core, right now it supports Ethereum. So the base blockchain on this one is an Ethereum. Coda right now, Coda is on still on development. I have not seen Coda still yet, so it is still not yet under public. Ethereum is under public. And the Ethereum which is used here is a kind of a different Ethereum. It is not the normal Ethereum which you use in your public net or the main net. Why? Because here the Ethereum platform uses the POA, which is proof of authority, not the proof of work, which is POW. Just because in an enterprise world, you cannot be waiting for someone to mine your transaction, which is obsolete, and then you can't wait. So that's why they come up with a concept called POA, which is proof of authority based on your roles. For example, if you belong to kind of a CTO role and then the finance manager, so there are some approval level goes through. So the transaction, whatever the transaction you post in within your organization, what happens is based on the approval cycle, this transaction get approved, escalator, and then it goes to a different level. And each level is tracked in the blockchain.
So isn't that a side chain on Ethereum?
What is that?
Because you say it's a part of Ethereum.
It's a Ethereum platform, yes.
So it's a side of Ethereum because Ethereum
kind of, yeah.
Yes,
it's a kind of traded off Ethereum. But all other features which is supported based on the Ethereum framework which is already here. And the development lifecycle which you do for the Ethereum, which is the Solidity file, you can use the same Solidity development and deploy your contract into the same Ethereum platform. So except that, it uses POA, not the POW. And it is a private consortium, not the public.
Yeah, so this one I'm saying, it is a sidechain of Ethereum.
Yes. It uses the base Ethereum platform. Okay. And if you see the architecture, it has a several component of the Azure as well. Any transaction or any transaction which you post in, they have a key wallet. And it is encrypted within the key wallet, and it is supported by default in the Azure. And whatever the transaction you post, say for example, if you are doing a small business, retail business, where you are tracking your order, your status, whatever the detail you post, it goes into multiple storages. First, it goes to SQL, okay, for transaction related. Then, which is called off-chain. And if you really want to push that into blockchain, it goes to the blockchain. So you have a control over what kind of transaction should be in the blockchain and what kind of transaction should not be in. Because blockchain is kind of heavy transaction one. You don't really want to track everything. If your organization want to have a blockchain just for the approved transaction, still you can. Or you want to just have a blockchain for only for tracking your product life cycle, you can still have. So all based on your rules as well. So there is an Azure logic application running in that decides on whether you want to have an off-chain or directly on the blockchain. So it all depends on how you change it. But any transaction and everything, it goes into the SQL also. Why? Because tomorrow, if your organization wants to have a Power BI or any of the reports of all the transaction happening or anything happening within the application, you can pull out from SQL rather than some blockchain. Because blockchain, you should not be burdening. It's like heavy transaction one. It is purely for transaction, not for doing some BI operations. So you should not be using the BI operations for transaction for blockchain. So they have it. So they have all the application transaction in SQL. Okay, and again for the transaction, you have a choice where you can choose Azure storage as well. Because some of the time your storage on the SQL will be expensive one. So you really don't want to store everything in SQL. So at that time you can have a choice to store in Azure storage, which is the blob, okay, which is less expensive than SQL. So you have a choice to store in the Azure blob as well. The other important feature which Microsoft by default provides you with that. This Azure Workbench also comes with web API, which means that you can run ASP.NET application or PHP or any application and call your API here, which is a REST API, supported API. For example, your transaction details, you are not running within the same Azure. You are running your own PHP application outside of Azure. Then you can call the web REST API and get all the details of the transaction as well. So by default, it comes with the REST API as well, REST API endpoint. And also, they have a Xamarin mobile app. If you are doing a small retail application where you want to track your order, then do a mobile posting, they already have a mobile application, which is Xamarin. Xamarin, which means that it works with both iOS and Android. They have the source code kind of as well. So later, if you want to modify, you can modify that. So the client side is also taken care. And it has an integration to the IoT hub as well. By default, it doesn't come with IoT hub when you spin up Azure blockchain workbench. But you can later spin up Azure IoT hub, then connect any multiple IoT devices and post your transaction. So whatever the transaction you post in, you can decide whether you want to have it in blockchain or off the block. Because IoT devices, it's like milliseconds. Milliseconds, it would generate a request, okay, through messaging. That you don't really want to put it in blockchain. So it depends on what is that you want to put in blockchain. And same, there is an Azure logic layer running in, which is like a rule engine. That decides where to do and what. Like when the IoT comes in, you can even write a logic. There is one sample application from Microsoft on the GitHub, like a refrigerator application. Think of a scenario where someone or a small shop wants to transport ice cream from one place to another place. During the transfer, there is a malfunctioning of a device, so the temperature of the ice cream become high, so the ice cream starts to melt. And you really set up a rule saying that if the temperature is less than or greater than certain threshold, it's not good for consumption, and you want to be alerted, and immediate action you want to take in. So that kind of a scenario, they already have a sample. So you add the sample, then the IoT devices, it starts to generate an input. So based on that temperature, you do something. So Azure logic is one of the rule set, which sets up all this logic. And based on that logic, your storage is like where you want to store your transaction, you can determine. So it has a tight integration with IoT Hub. And some of the samples, Microsoft has also uploaded a sample wherein you can log the integration with SharePoint as well. In some organization, they want to track, or they already have a document repository where they want to make use of the SharePoint, then you can even use the SharePoint integrate to it. There are sample source code also available, which will insert an item, list item into the SharePoint. So that is a kind of a connector. Okay. So that is the main objective of the Azure blockchain workbench. Okay. So this is just a sample. I don't know whether it is valid till now. This I took it 2-3 months back. So the services changes, the cost changes. This is just a rough estimate of cost, monthly cost, okay, which would occur for a basic setup of Azure blockchain workbench. Because when you spin up Azure blockchain workbench, behind the scene, it does so many spin up. Like it spins up virtual machines, it spins up a private network, so it does so many of the operations. So it creates so many of these components, which will accumulate to come around that price. Okay, it is just the estimated, not the exact. It varies based on the region plus. Okay, and for the Ethereum platform at the background, it creates a single node. Okay, single node, but it has a failover as well, which means that VM is running. It's a virtual scale set. One, if one VM is down, the other VM will take over. So it is kind of HA taken care. Okay, single node.
What's the number here? It's 5,000.
Oh, you cannot see that.
What are you going for?
It's annual. Okay, monthly it would be around something like 8, I guess. That is annual, sorry. Monthly around, yeah, it's a 5,000 yearly. The resolution has some issue with it.
So, by blockchain as a service, it's a little bit like your cloud as a service.
Yes.
Depending on your usage, it's like different subscription bands or something.
Yes, it's kind of a usage, based on the usage as well. Okay, so maybe I'll show you my Azure. I will duplicate. Is the resolution okay? So if you see, I have one Azure. Okay. So if you see here, at this one, these are the components which are created when you create an Azure Workbench, which is like the event grid, which I mentioned you for posting the messages between your SQL or offline or chain. The event grid takes care of messaging services. The load balancer is for load balancing your virtual machines. So if you are running on a multiple zones, the load balancer also takes care of routing of your application inside your blockchain. And as I mentioned to you, there is a key vault. Any transaction or anything you put in, it already encrypts your messages. Okay? They run automatically, the key vault. You don't need to do anything. It is automatically being configured. The first time when you create, everything is done for you. This is a plain vanilla of Azure blockchain, which I created. I didn't touch anything. And these two are the primary web applications. The API is the web application API, which I mentioned to you, the REST API. If you want to create your own application outside of the Azure or outside of whatever you are planning for, like ASP.NET application or PHP, even HTML5, you can call the API, the REST API. It returns you the JSON file. Then based on the JSON, you can create your own application outside of it. And this is the main application, URL of the blockchain application. Later, I show you a small demo where how do they do the blockchain application. I told you that blockchain as a service. Why? Because you can create even a multiple blockchain application on your organization. Say, for example, you can create an asset management as a separate blockchain application and deploy it inside here. And the whole organization can make use of the asset transfer application, and it will be running on the Azure. And they can make use of that blockchain application. It's like a mini D app deployed into your Ethereum. That's it. And similarly, you can create multiple blockchain application and deploy into your application. Then each application behaves like on their own. And you can even apply your role permissions based on that. Roles, okay? And the other thing I want to show you is the virtual machines. There is a SQL server and the SQL database, which I mentioned to you, off-chain. Any data you want to put in, the transaction can be off-chain and online. Online, which is the chain, inside your chain. Okay, and then important thing about the virtual machines. Okay, so these are the virtual machines. Basically, they run the Linux virtual machine, which runs on the Ethereum. And if you are really keen about deploying your own Solidity program behind inside into the Ethereum, you can still do. By default, they lock the Ethereum blockchain. So you'll have to unlock using your passcode, then you deploy your Solidity. Your basic Solidity programming, which comes with whatever the Solidity programming you do and deploy, like the Truffle, everything applies here as well. You create your Solidity program, use the Truffle, deploy, build, and then you can deploy your contract directly there. But Microsoft has other way to deploy Solidity program plus your application also there. Okay, I'll show you one of the application which they already have. Okay, so when the first time you spin out Azure blockchain workbench, it creates a website. Automatically it creates a website. Later I have a workshop. If you have a laptop, I go through. You have to do a preliminary setup to make it to work with the Active Directory, then deployment. So there are preliminary setup. It would take not maximum of 2 to 3 hours if you are pro in Azure and other stuff. If you are very new, depends on your expertise, it might take time. Okay, for me it took around 2 hours, then subsequently you can do the setup. And Microsoft has several applications, simple to complex applications, which is already in the GitHub. Later I show you the URL. If you follow my workshop today, you can play around multiple later. Okay, this is one of the simple application which Microsoft provides you, which is the Hello blockchain. What happens here is, so this application, if you see here, it has a Solidity file as well as the JSON file. I'll show you. Okay, which is here. Document presentation, blockchain, and then the apps. Okay. The clarity is not good. Okay, so if you see here, if you are a blockchain programmer and you are doing the Solidity program, you can still follow the same Solidity. This is a contract file, so which is a typical contract which you are writing in. This is a very simple contract which is already uploaded into GitHub. What does it does is, you post a message. It is like your messaging app. You post a message, the message goes into the blockchain, gets the ID, address, all those. Then you someone who is on the other side gets a message. He logs in and then see the message, he can post a reply. So it's just a messaging app, Hello app. It's a sample, very simple sample, which Microsoft already has it. You can deploy these two files and it becomes your application. It is like you are creating a mini kind of a dApp. So you're not literally going into the Ethereum and deploying and other stuff. If you have your Solidity file and the JSON file, which takes care of the configuration, this is a JSON file, which takes care of the configuration. So what it does is, this JSON file tells to the Azure blockchain that there is a Solidity file and this is the contract detail, you just deploy. So you don't really go into the developer approach of Truffle and other stuff. So this is one of the way Microsoft gives you to deploy your kind of a dApps application into your enterprise. So your enterprise always will use this URL. Okay? So this URL becomes like your main URL application, and you can keep on uploading different applications into it. Like Hello blockchain, you can create one more asset transfer. which is already there. Then you upload. So I'd show you one sample. So for example, I can create one more new application. It asks you for the JSON file, which is already there in the GitHub. Say for example, I use the asset transfer. Then the Solidity file, which is your core programming. So once these two files are already there, you just deploy. So the JSON file is the key file which tells you what this asset transfer program does. Then it deploys into the Ethereum. So behind the scene, the Microsoft program, already there are several processes running in. I told you that EventGrid and other process running in, which will take care of deploying this Solidity into your Ethereum. So you don't really have to be a developer to go there and deploy and other stuff. But obviously you have to test with the behind the scene with the developer and creating the Solidity. But once those configuration and the Solidity file are there, you can create the application from the web application itself. Okay? And this asset transfer application is already there. So once it is there, then you can assign the role. So right now there are zero members. You will have to assign the role because, as I told you, this is proof of authority. So you'll have to have the users and assign the roles. So based on each application, you can create your own role. So administrator can add only applications. So right now I'm administrator. I can add only applications. I cannot interact with this application. I cannot post any message to hello. I cannot create any asset. So I have only role to deploy, that's it. And similarly, you can create multiple users, and these users are adhered to the Active Directory, okay? So they can pull from Active Directory. So any user within your organization, which is automatically inside AD, everyone will be here. And you pull the user and then just assign what is the role he is going to do, that's it. And these roles you have to define. It doesn't come automatically. Your blockchain application should decide what are the roles it should have. And based on the role, your contract should be programmed. So those kind of thing are further detail level. So you have to be kind of programmer. On top of it, this provides multiple applications. So which means this becomes like your mini kind of a store. Then you add more and more dApps or kind of an apps inside, I would say. Okay. So that's how the basics of blockchain. Okay. So this one, right now I didn't add anyone. So and the intention of this workshop actually is to make the for you to run through and then bring this website up in your Azure. Okay, that was the intention. So if you have the laptop, then I'll start with the workshop. Okay, you can follow on. I have uploaded the steps, one each steps with the screenshot taken from my site, from my Azure, and uploaded into GitHub. So it's not that you have to try now and then not there. You can even try once you go home and then. But make sure the moment you start spinning Azure blockchain workbench, your credit starts to die off. $100 is very, very less. So within 2-3 days, your credit will run out. Okay? Every day, for me, every day it takes around $40 to $48. Okay, depends on the service. So maybe in 2 or 3 days it will go off. Okay. Yeah.
So this was taken. Can you send it to the emails registered here?
Yeah, workshop? I can give it to him and then he can post it as a comment or I don't know how it is.
Yeah.
The URL, I can show the URL as well. Okay, so I don't know what is this resolutions. Okay, so this URL, I have uploaded the Word document which contains every step. Okay, so right from the step, how do you register your Azure pass, then go through your Azure Workbench. It has everything almost. So till to the landing page which you see, the Hello blockchain, till to that, there is a step by step. Actually, I just followed the documentation from the Microsoft, but Microsoft documentation, you have to be a pro because you have to read every line and then go through it. Instead, I slightly make it a bit easier with my screenshots and then make sure that you understand each step. Then finally, you will get through your thing. The Microsoft main site, which is docs.microsoft blockchain, they missed one step as well. So I have added that step also to make it to work. Right now it is only Ethereum. In future they are planning to support Corda. I don't know when.
What about Hyperledger?
Hyperledger also they mentioned, but I have not seen. Yeah, they say they would start to support Corda and Hyperledger, but still not there. Yes, yeah, which is like Azure Blockchain Workbench. So it is not called as Azure Blockchain as a Service. It is called as Azure Blockchain Workbench inside Azure. Okay, but if you are a core Ethereum programmer, they have another choice, which is Ethereum Consortium. So you can spin up the Linux machine with two nodes, then you can keep on adding a node, so you can do the setup. So by default, they give you one consortium, private consortium. That is a different template. And also they have a Hyperledger template, but not on this. So that is a different template also they have. The event grid, which is the messaging, event grid. So event grid is inside the Azure, which takes care of, it's like a queue. Anything, any transaction comes in, they just dump it in a central queue. The queue decides on where to dispatch the message in SQL off-chain or the blockchain. So that is decided by a rule, which is in your control. But yes. Can be customized, but right now everything goes into the event grid, which is like your queue piping system. So it just goes there, dispatch, and they have several connectors. So SQL has one connector, blockchain has one connector, I mean within that. So it decides, because the translation of the message has to be taken care, right? So they translate, because for a blockchain it has to be signed with the private key. So they do all this, everything is taken care inside. It is not Quorum, it is Ethereum, just Ethereum, plain Ethereum, not Corda. Think of like Ethereum base, and they just create an address, address of the transaction, and they just post it. That's it, inside the Ethereum. So every message is just one transaction and posted into the block. It's a block, that's it. Same as a, exactly same as the blockchain Ethereum, that's it. So the underlying is Ethereum. They just give you the framework or the platform. Then you decide what you want to do.
Eventually, you can choose whether you want to push the transaction back to the Ethereum main chain.
That one is...
Mainnet,
which is, you mean the public mainnet?
Yeah.
That cannot be done because this is POA. I don't know whether you can integrate directly with the mainnet. I have not tried, but I'm not sure. I don't know whether, because the version might vary. It is a POA, the mainnet is POW. So the base itself changes. Yeah, also, I have not tried the token system. Token system is there, the token system is slightly different on the mainnet token system, because the mainnet token system again adheres to POW. Here the token system is POA. So when you create a token here, the authorization, approval, all these things goes through your authority based. In the mainnet, everything is POW. So the token also varies.
Okay.
Other things are all almost the same. It's underlying Ethereum. So every transaction you do, there is a gas value. But the main difference is that mainnet, someone is running a virtual machine like a EVM, and they take care of all the charging. Here, it's your VM. So your VM and you are paying. But the logic is all the same. The gas and your calculation is all the same. It's a base Ethereum. And if you want to, say for example, you are from one department running your blockchain. If the other department wants to consume, and when the other department consumes it, you want to charge it, then you can play around with this gas and charge them. Okay? But it's all you have to decide, and it's a programming. You have to calculate your gas value, your transaction, plus the POA when every transaction happens. How do you charge? What is the value of your? So all these things you should take care. I don't know. Oh, users are taken care of. Yes. Yes. So blockchain is just a plain vanilla of Ethereum. On top of it, you do your authorization, authentication. So it is all based on Active Directory, and then you program it. Okay. The pizza, you want to call off or? Maybe I'll start with the registration then. So the subsequent session, I want to take it as a workshop. If it is good, you have a laptop, or you can follow it. If you follow it, then I'll be faster. Then I'll finish quicker. If you are doing exactly on the laptop, then you might have some doubt. Then it takes some time. Then you'll understand. I don't know how you want to take through. If you want to really take through the laptop, I can do. Or I'll just go through the steps. It will be finished in half an hour or something. If you are really doing it, it takes really more time. And you will learn it in just today. But before that, before I start the original, the core lab, make sure this you have to go through if you really want to make use of the Azure, irrespective of this blockchain, or you can run your virtual machine for 1 month, okay, free. So $100, you can run 2-3 virtual machine, shut down when it is not needed. That's what I do. Every month, my credit will not be more than 200, okay? Because I have 4 virtual machine, I run only when I need. And they have a very good option of shutting down based on the time. So every day, what I do is shut down the virtual machine irrespective of at 6 p.m. because by 6 p.m. I'll finish the work. So automatically, it will shut down. There is no charge. Okay? So basically, if you want to register, I keep repeating the same. Because live ID, you need to have a live ID to register, and this free Azure pass is for 30 days, okay, and 100 USD, that's it. And you should use the Azure, Microsoft Azure Pass.com, which I shown you before. Once you log into that, you would see the screen, click on start, then it'll automatically try to log in. This login screen comes up only if your Internet Explorer or Chrome or whatever the browser you logged in is not logged with live ID before. If you have already logged in with Live ID, this screen will go off. It will automatically take through your previous logged in Live ID. So be careful. First, one time it happened to me. My personal Live ID started to register. So I really don't want my personal Live ID there. Okay. And once you confirm your Live ID, you confirm it. And when you confirm it, it will ask you for this promo code. Make sure that you copy that promo code and put it in there. Then it goes through your process, which is like, it asks for the phone number, but you can type anything. It doesn't check or it doesn't send any SMS to validate and come back. So you can just type 123456, any mobile number. Because the main objective of this free pass is that there is not much of a difference between the free pass and the original Azure site, and then you can enroll free. The main difference is that when you go to the main Azure site, portal.azure.com, and try to register, you have to give your credit card. Okay? That is like you really want don't want to write. So that is the main difference between the portal and the free pass which he is given today. So the free pass is like, you are anonymous, just want to try, throw it out. So in that case, you really don't want to give your mobile number as well. Email ID, you have to specify the valid email ID. This is a different email ID for contact, apart from the live ID. But in most of the case, you use the same live ID. So you can copy paste the live ID. Email ID, better you give the same email ID which you try to register, because sometimes message when it want to authenticate certain services within Azure, which would be much easier for you. Okay. And there is an agreement. And finally, when it is ready, you will see the screen, which is the Azure login screen. Okay. So that's how you should register your Azure pass. And then you should go through creation of Azure Workbench, which I would go through. Okay. If you really want to try, you can start now, and then you can create the workbench, and then go for a pizza. Because creation, it would take minimum of 10 to 15 minutes. Okay, the whole service to run, because they create so many of the virtual machine, they set up so many things. So it takes 10 to 15 minutes. Last night it took me 1 hour. Okay, I don't know whether something wrong with the Azure service. I really want to do the setup and then go to sleep. Only at that time it took 1 hour. I thought it will finish in 15 minutes. Within 1 hour I'll do the setup. It took 1 hour just to provision. The whole night is gone. So I don't know. It depends on the region plus the services.
Does it matter if other people are on, so more people it slows down?
Based on the region, maybe some of the services is down in the region. The same I tried today evening, it went in just 10 minutes. All the services were there.
So, I mean, charge you for that?
No. I mean, once it is spinned on, then they charge, obviously. Yeah, they charge for that. By the charge will be on seconds and the minutes time. So 1 hour, by the time the VM starts to run, then you'll be charged. Yeah, it all depends on the computation. Okay. So if you really want to try and follow now, my suggestion, you start the service now, then you go for a pizza. Or you can go for the pizza, then I would just run through the lab. Later you can just try it at home or whenever you're free. Okay? Yeah. So pizza, anyone who is trying out, or I can, you're trying out? Okay. So I'll just run through 2-3 steps, then you can go for the pizza. Okay. So have you already logged into the Azure? Okay. So if you are already logged into the Azure, you create the resource group first. You click on the resource group on the left. And then you add a resource group, new resource group. This is not a mandatory step, but resource group is kind of your grouping. It is really helpful when you want to completely delete all the services which you are creating. Okay, this step is not mandatory, but my suggestion, you follow some standard. So all the services you create will be under one group. Then eventually it is easier to delete. Okay, so click on add resource group. Then it would prompt you to enter the name of the resource group. It's up to you what you enter in. For some kind of easy understanding for the future, just to see what is that resource group is, you create with some abbreviation. Like in my case, I created as AWB, which is Azure Workbench. You can even type the full, but it's up to you. Okay, create a resource group, type the name, and make sure the region, it's very careful with the region. If you have chosen US, everything is going to be slow. Okay, you cannot expect it to finish it faster. So type Southeast Asia, which is the closest for Singapore. There is no Singapore, so you can choose Southeast Asia. And click on the review and the create. Okay, I didn't specify the name, that's why it gives the error.
So is the resource, which group of the resources?
This is just a tagging of name, that's it. It doesn't tied to any of the thing. Just the tagging of a name, grouping. Grouping of all your resources. Which one? Because even in the resource group, you can specify that any of the resources I'm adding into that automatically tied to this Southeast Asia region. That's it. So whenever you create more and more, like virtual machine you create a private network, everything, every time you don't have to specify the region. When your resource group is tied to the region already, it all the thing inside will automatically tie to the region. It is like tagging. That's it. Yes. Yes. Yes.
And because it's two pack in US, so it's not
directional. If you choose other region, then the server is somewhere in that region. So it is going to be your network latency. Yeah. There'll be slightly a slowness. You don't see much difference. You see much difference when you spin up a website, VM. So I just give a name, review and create, and click on create. So once you click on create, you should see the notification saying that it is successfully created, and you will see the resource group on the left. So you have finished creating. Once you finish creating, click on the resource group. On the right side, you will see add. And you would have a search screen. So here you would see all the services which Azure provides you. Search for blockchain. You will have so many of the blockchain. If you see here, they have so many services on blockchain, which I mentioned you before even. Okay, so this is Ethereum with the POA consortium, and they have the Hyperledger consortium. If you want to have a Hyperledger, just the core Hyperledger, and also they have Ethereum, the Quorum, which is already there, Coda, and there was one Ethereum consortium as well, apart from this. This is POA Ethereum, not the same as mainnet, different. There is one more Ethereum consortium, I don't know what happened in mine, okay. So our thing is here, which is the blockchain. Select that. It gives you the detail. Then click on create. It takes a while, but it is not creating. It is just provisioning first, okay. So it comes to the basic screen. Here you have to specify all the detail. Prefix, my suggestion, you always give a like three letter, because prefix is the one which is going to be appended in all the services. If you give it as a long, sometime the website URL or the API it creates, you might have an issue. I had issue when I have a long name, okay? My suggestion, always keep it very short, like AWP, AXS, so something which you can understand, okay? And also it validates your prefix. Then I mentioned you, it creates a Ethereum virtual machine at the background. And if you are giving that to a developer, for example, you already have an in-house Ethereum developer who are very good in Solidity programming. He wants to make use of the direct backdoor of the virtual machine. Then you should know the username and password. So make sure that this username and password is given to the developer or to the one who manages the Ethereum directly can use it. Okay, and you should follow the approaches as well. And the password as such, and also you can specify a different database and password. This is for SQL Server, because it creates an SQL Server. Again, make sure that you select Southeast Asia region here, okay? You have choice. And the resource group, whatever you have created right now, the resource group, and the location, by default it comes out, okay? So choose everything, then go to click on, make sure that you click on OK, because whatever the option you select there, if you don't click OK, the second step, it is all gone, okay? It doesn't allow test 1, 2, 3, 4. Southeast Asia, then I would choose Something like AWZ. Okay. Everything has. Okay. Great. Okay. Southeast Asia. Make sure you select okay. Then it goes to the second step. Here you can, by default, set all the thing. My suggestion, you disable this monitoring. Monitoring is like your operation manager. Sometimes it takes long if you enable this to deploy. This is for the monitoring your virtual machine, your network, more of infrastructure guys. Infrastructure guys, if there is a, if your server is down, why it is down? So those kind of monitoring, not the transaction monitoring, okay? Nothing to do with the business related. It is a completely infrastructure underlying network monitoring, your machine monitoring, your Windows server monitoring, so all these things. Usually I disable this for testing because it adds up some more time for deploying. And all other thing you can set default. Make sure that you created as a new network. You are not joining to the existing network. If you are joining, there are several steps. You should know your SSH password, all your details of your existing Ethereum. Okay, and this one is the one which consumes so much of the memory. Standard and the premium. Premium is extremely costly. It will run out in just one day. Okay, not even one day. So they charge you so much. It's like SSD, not the simple one. So leave it to default, which is standard SSD. And this you can change. This is the one which decides what is the type of VM you are going to run. Again, this is the one which consumes more of the charge. Sometime I try to change it, but for you, the new guys, we just accept it, okay? Click OK, then it goes to the next step, which is just a summary, that's it. So once it is done, it validates. It takes 1 minute, maybe 1 or 2 minutes to validate all your entries, just the summary page. And once it is validated, then it goes to, then the OK is enabled. Make sure that you click OK. Okay, see? You can even download the template and parameter. Whatever you have chosen, think of like you are an IT infrastructure guy, you are provisioning this blockchain for multiple instances. You can use this template. Template is just a JSON file. You go there, modify, use it for subsequent deployment. If you are deploying for test, production, UAT, you don't need to do all this stuff every time, come and click, click, click. Download this JSON, change the parameter, just run it at the background of Azure. They have their own things, okay? Click OK, hopefully it doesn't start to create. Then buy option. Okay? So immediately don't check this, okay? This is just to get the concept whether they can share your email and the details, okay? Immediately when you see the checkbox, don't check that, terms and use. So this is just extra thing. What they are asking is read that, permission to use or share your information. So obviously you don't want to. So then click on create, that's it. So if you are doing your workshop now, start the create now, it might take 15 minutes max.